We're doing the Kyrie as well at the time. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Welcome. Thank you for gathering with us this morning. We gather on the Haldimand Tract of 1784, the traditional lands of the Haudenosaunee, the Anishinaabe, and the Neutral peoples who've cared for this land for thousands of years. I invite you to pop by on Zoom later this morning at 11 a.m. and on every Sunday at 11 a.m. for our coffee, our weekly coffee and conversation on Zoom. You can find the link in your Thursday newsletter. Also, a reminder, next Sunday, or actually next Saturday night before you retire and go to bed, remember to turn your clocks forward by 1 hour. That is the time of year. This is the time of year again. I invite you to join in singing God of Grace and God of Glory, number 705.
God of grace.
Join me in the responses to the Kyrie.
Kyrie.
Let us pray. Holy One, Creator of the stars and seas, your steadfast love is shown to every living thing. Your word calls forth countless worlds and souls. Your law revives and refreshes. Forgive our misuse of your gifts, that we may be transformed by your wisdom to manifest for others the mercy of our crucified and risen Lord. Amen.
A reading from Exodus, the 20th chapter. God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquity of parents to the third and fourth generation of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. You shall not do any work. You, your son, or your daughter, or your male or female slave, your livestock, or the alien resident in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them, but rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it. Honor your father and mother, so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or male or female slave or ox or donkey or anything that belongs to your neighbor. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
The heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky proclaims its vapors and the word.
One day tells its tale to another, and one night imparts knowledge to another.
Although they have no words or language, and their voices are not heard,
their sound has gone out into all lands, and their message to the ends of the world, where God has pitched a tent for the sun.
It comes forth like a bridegroom out of his chamber. It rejoices like a champion to run its course.
It goes forth from the uttermost edge of the heavens and runs about to the end of it again. Nothing is hidden from its burning heat.
The teaching of the Lord is perfect and revives the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, and give wisdom to the simple.
The statutes of the Lord are just and rejoice the heart. The commandment of the Lord is clear and gives light to the eyes.
The fear of the Lord is clean and endures forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous altogether.
More to be desired are they than gold, more than much fine gold, sweeter far than honey in the comb.
By them also is your servant enlightened, and in keeping them there is great reward.
Who can detect one's own offenses? Cleanse me from my secret faults.
Above all, keep your servant from presumptuous sins. Let them not get dominion over me. Then shall I be whole and sound and innocent of a great offense.
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer.
A reading from 1 Corinthians. The message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, It is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided, through the foolishness of our proclamation, to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs, and Greeks desire wisdom, but we proclaim Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles, but to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. For God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
The Passover of the Jews was near, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and the money changers seated at their tables. Making a whip of cords, he drove all of them out of the temple, both the sheep and the cattle. He also poured out the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. He told those who were selling doves, "Take these things out of here. Stop making my Father's house a marketplace." His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and will you raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the word that Jesus had spoken. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Jesus angrily overturns tables and causes disruption and havoc, and this in the most revered and holy places at the time, the Jerusalem Temple. It's an image of Jesus that we don't readily embrace, that doesn't square with our preferred image of Jesus. You know, the nice Jesus, the calm, likable, get along Jesus. But the angry Jesus, the public disruptor, the disturber of public peace, decorum, order, status quo, overturning money exchange tables, spilling coins on the ground everywhere, using a whip and hitting everyone and everything in sight, trying to drive them all out of the temple. There's no wonder the police soon thereafter arrest Jesus and put him away, this disturber and disruptor. So what are we to make of this? I take this upending imagery as indicative of how the Spirit of God operates in our hearts and in our world. Just as Jesus physically upended the tables, upending the temple economy, upending the sacrificial system of temple worship, all in order to shift the focus from the temple to him as the way to worship God, so too does the Spirit of God today upend our habits, practices, and perspectives which are no longer life-giving, all in order to breathe new life into the world, to restore loving, just relationships, to inject life-giving, invigorating energy and hope into our constricted hearts and broken world. For God so loved the world and continues to do so. One of the perennial human problems from the beginning of time, as identified as one of the seven deadly sins in Middle Age theology and addressed by the Ten Commandments and hinted at through the Apostle Paul's talk of the world's foolishness compared to God's wisdom, is the perennial human problem of apathy, of simply not caring, of being so preoccupied only about one's small little world and self-seeking advancement that one ends up ignoring and being totally blinded to the wider world and universe out there. Psychologists and theologians have said that we don't see things as they are. We see things as we are. We see the things we want to see, the things that merely confirm our own assumptions and biases and preferred way of looking at the world. We kind of only like cherry pick the information data coming at us, pick some things but reject others. It could be an intentional coping mechanism of how we deal with realities we'd rather not, difficult realities of suffering and pain in us or others. And so we embrace either intentional amnesia or intentional anesthesia. We either deny those realities through distractions or numb them with addictions. Apathy, amnesia, or anesthesia, render us blind to a bigger reality out there, and often realities of suffering and pain. Jesus upends our apathy, amnesia, or anesthesia, waking us up, breaking open new visions, new perspectives, a spaciousness of awareness of a world much larger than our own. The first time I was privileged to visit Washington, D.C. was on a road trip that my mom and dad and brother and I took in the late 1970s. I remember in our 1978 rather new car, the Mercury Zephyr. And I remember I was 8 or 9 years old, and Jimmy Carter was president of the United States at the time. My memories of that first visit to Washington, D.C. are scant, understandably, but one memory stands out. At one point on our visit, I remember we happened to be driving through the neighborhood immediately north of the White House, a couple of blocks north of the White House. And that neighborhood, I remember, felt to us scary, sketchy, unsafe. I recall that sort of general feeling or impression. And we talked inside the car. I remember driving through. My mom called it the slums of D.C. back in the late 70s. Right? That neighborhood seemed kind of dirty and run down and neglected. We didn't feel safe, preferring to stay in the car and get to wherever we were going as fast as possible. I remember that impression. I remember those feelings around the visual memory of that. But today, looking back on that memory, and my mom and I had a recent phone conversation about this, we also recalled that most, if not all, the people that we saw on the sidewalks, hanging around, getting around in that particular neighborhood, were Black. And we wondered, on the phone, we wondered how much of our sense of unease or fear at the time had to do not so much with the fact of the general poor and run-down conditions of that section of the neighborhood, but more with the fact that the majority of people we were seeing in the neighborhood were people of color. See, my parents grew up in a predominantly white European Poland. And my mom admitted to me that it wasn't until she was about 30 or 35 years of age and while in London, England, that she ever even saw a person of color, first person of color. And she realizes today how from a very young age, that lack of personal contact, let alone friendship, with anyone of color can lead, if not unchecked, to hurtful biases and prejudices. This early childhood memory of Washington, D.C. got me thinking about my own privileged white experiences and biases. And I was thinking 2 years ago, some of you know, I visited my ancestral lands of Poland. And after I came home, I suddenly realized how strange it was that while I was there, I never saw anyone of color. Anywhere, nowhere. Everybody was white, whether I was visiting southern Poland or even spending a few days in the capital city of Poland in Warsaw. Well, big city, lots of people. I never recall at any time seeing anyone of color. And this is modern day Europe, 2019. Where were they? And even though statistically, if you look it up, there is a small black population in Poland, the overwhelming predominance of white people was palpable and obvious. You can see how easy it is for anyone, such as my parents, growing up and living in a predominantly white population, can come to see as white people as representing the norm, the standard. We see this bias sneak in, for example, in historic religious artwork, where key biblical figures, including Jesus, have been portrayed as white. Jesus is an Anglo or Germanic European white man with long hair and angelic-looking blue eyes. When in actual historical biblical fact, they were all people of color with brown or black skin. Global population statistics remind us that the strictly white population on planet Earth is a minority, only around 30%. This is all to say that there is a far bigger world out there than our own small personal inward bubbles in which we live and conduct our lives. And Jesus bursts those bubbles, upending our biases, broadening our vision, our perspective, our awareness of the big, diverse, interesting, good world out there. The reality is, as Martin Luther King Jr. wrote, we are all caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. This is the universe that God created in the first place that we read about in the book of Genesis, where all people, all living things have a place, all belong, all are loved and valued. And any practice or habit or perspective which violates this original God-ordained intent for God's creation really should be upended and overturned, so the world can breathe again. We sing our hymn, Canticle of the Turning, number 723.
My soul cries out with a joyful shout, that the God of my heart is great. And my spirit sings of the wondrous things that brings to the ones who wait. You fixed your sight on your servant's plight, and amazes it through their spurn. So from east to west shall my name be blessed, the world be about to turn. My heart shall sing on the day you bring, that the fires of your justice burn. Wipe away all tears, for the dawn draws near, and the world is about to turn. Though I am small, my God, my all, you who work great things in me, and your mercy will last from the depths of the past to the end of the age to be. Your very name puts the proud to shame, and to those who would do for yearn. You will show your might, put the strong to flight, for the world is about to turn. My heart shall sing for the day you bring, let the fires of your justice burn. Wipe away all tears, for the dawn draws near, and the world is about to turn. From the halls of power to the forest tower, not a stone will be left on stone. Let the king beware of your densest tears, every tear right from this throne. The hungry poor shall weep no more for the food you can never earn. There the table spread, every mouth be fed, and the world is about to turn. My heart shall bring up the day you bring, the fires of your justice burn. Wipe away all tears, for the dawn draws near, and the world is about to turn. Through the nations rage, age to age, remember who holds us fast. God's mercy must deliver us from the conqueror's crushing grasp. This servant word, the poor first bear, and they pour from the fruits of God. Till the spear and the rod and the crushed by God, turning the world around. My heart shall sing on the day we bring, that the fires of your justice burn. Wipe away all tears, for the dawn draws near, and the world is about to
relying on the promises of God, we pray boldly for the church, the world, and all in need, singing the response.
For God alone my soul awaits in
there is no God before you. Purify the faith of your church, that your people place their trust in nothing beside you. Your name is holy. Guide your church, that in every situation, your people's words and actions honor your name. Hear us, O God.
For God alone my soul awaits in silence.
The heaven heavens declare your glory. Renew your creation. Provide leaders in the struggle for clean air and water. Protect creatures and crops that rely on healthy ecosystems. Give all people the willingness to repent when our way of life pollutes the earth and the skies. Hear us, O God.
For God alone, so awaits in silence.
Your foolishness is wiser than human wisdom. Fill leaders with the foolishness of your peace and mercy. Your law defends the vulnerable. Work through legislators, judicial and law enforcement systems to protect the well-being and freedom of all, especially people of color and people with low incomes struggling to have food and shelter. Hear us, O God.
For God alone, my soul awaits in silence.
Your weakness is stronger than human strength. Protect those who are vulnerable and give courage to all who are suffering, especially these we now name in our heart. Monica, Allie, Flo, David, Jeff, Peter, Julie, Chad, Eileen. Give Sabbath rest to all who labor. Hear us, O God.
For God alone, my soul awaits in silence.
You call us to proclaim Christ crucified. Give clarity to this congregation and our leaders, so that we might follow Christ beyond our own habits and comfort. Clear out anything in our common life that would obscure the gospel or that serves our own interests. Bless the decision process about the church land, that the land may serve to be a blessing to others and our wider community. Hear us, O God.
For God alone, my soul awaits in silence.
The cross of Christ is your power for all who are being saved. Thank you for all the saints, martyrs, servants of the gospel, and those we've loved who have entered your eternal realm and whose witness reveals the power of the cross. Especially Gio. Give us the same trust in life and in death. Hear us, O God.
For God alone, my soul awaits in silence.
We entrust ourselves and all our prayers to you, O faithful God, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It
It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You call your people to cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that renewed in the gift of baptism, we may come to the fullness of your grace. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed are you, O God of the universe. Your mercy is everlasting, and your faithfulness endures from age to age. Praise to you for creating the heavens and the earth. Praise to you for saving the earth from the waters of the flood. Praise to you for bringing the Israelites safely through the sea. Praise to you for leading your people through the wilderness of the land of milk and honey. Praise to you for the words and deeds of Jesus, your anointed one. Praise to you for the death and resurrection of Christ. Praise to you for your Spirit poured out on all nations. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And again after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." With this bread and cup, we remember our Lord's Passover from death to life as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. O God of resurrection and new life, pour out your Holy Spirit on us and on these gifts of bread and wine. Bless this feast. Grace our table with your presence. Come, Holy Spirit. Reveal yourself to us in the breaking of the bread. Raise us up as the body of Christ for the world. Breathe new life into us. Send us forth, burning with justice, peace, and love. Come, Holy Spirit. With all your holy ones of all times and places, with the earth and all its creatures, with sun and moon and stars, we praise you, O God, blessed and holy Trinity, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray the prayer Jesus taught his disciples in whichever language or version you prefer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The body of Christ is given for you. Take and eat the bread of life. Body of Christ is given for you. The body of Christ is given. body of Christ is given for you. Reiner, the body of Christ is given for you. You are what God made you, created in Christ Jesus for good works, chosen as holy and beloved, freed to serve your neighbor. God bless you, that you may be a blessing. In the name of the Holy and life-giving Trinity. Amen. Amen. We sing "In the Cross of Christ I Glory," number 324. Go in peace and share the good news. Thanks be to God.